Hello, and welcome to Esquire Group's webinar on the U.S. taxation of foreign investment in U.S. real estate. My name is Jimmy Sexton. So first of all, as with anything involving U.S. tax and Esquire Group, we always want to do a little disclaimer that this webinar is being given for informational purposes only. It was prepared for educational purposes. It is not tax or legal advice, nor should it be construed as such. Each individual circumstances are different. You should seek legal and/or tax advice to address any specific questions that you may have. Just about myself briefly. Again, my name is Jimmy Sexton. I have a bachelor's in business administration with an emphasis in finance, a JD in LL.M in international taxation. I'm the founder and CEO of Esquire Group, which is an international tax advisory firm with offices in Austria, Germany, the US, and the United Arab Emirates. I specialize in strategic consulting and international taxation, including US citizens with foreign income or assets, expatriation, family offices, succession planning, structures for high net worth individuals, and corporate structures for SMEs, as well as foreign investment in the United States. I'm fluent in English and German. If you wanna know more about me, the link is here on the slides and at esquiregroup.com. You can check out my full bio. So again, this webinar is on the U.S. taxation of foreign investments in U.S. real estate. So I think the very first thing that we have to do is determine who is a foreign investor. So if we're talking about an individual, a foreign investor is somebody who is not a United States citizen, somebody that does not have a green card, and somebody who does not meet what's known as the substantial presence test. The substantial presence test is a relatively complex test, but basically the substantial presence test is a test whereby if you meet the substantial presence test, you can be considered a U.S. tax resident simply by spending too much time in the United States. So foreign investor is somebody who's not a U.S. citizen, does not have a green card, and does not meet the substantial presence test. That is for individual investors. A foreign investor could also be a foreign corporation or a foreign trust or a foreign partnership. Or moving right along, what type of taxation is a foreign investor subject to? So there's basically three types of U.S. taxation that a foreign investor. The first is ongoing income taxation of things like rent, so income that is produced by the real estate. Second type is what's known as the Foreign Investment Real Property Tax Act of 1980, FRPTA for short. This is a type of taxation that applies on the disposition of real estate by a foreign investor. And you also have to be concerned with estate and gift taxation of U.S. real estate owned by a foreign investor. Now, this next one, the Bureau of Economic Analysis reporting, this isn't actually a tax requirement, but it's an often overlooked U.S. compliance requirement. So I thought that I would bring it up in this webinar to make you guys aware of it so that you can comply with it if need be. First, we're going to take a look at the ongoing income taxation of U.S. real estate owned by a foreign investor. So there's basically two ways that the ongoing income of U.S. real estate owned by a foreign investor can be taxed. There's what's called the gross basis and the net basis. We're first going to talk about the gross basis. Now, the gross basis is the default way that a foreign investor is taxed on income produced by U.S. real estate. And a lot of people are very surprised to hear of how the U.S. taxes foreign investors by default. And so the gross basis applies to passive rental income. So you own a house or an office building, something like that, and you're just receiving passive rents. What most people don't realize is that the default method of taxation is 30% withholding of the gross rent. So it's not like in most countries where you have, you know, your rental income, you deduct your expenses and you pay profit, or you pay tax on the profit. No, In the United States, the default way of taxing the rental income of a foreign investor is 30% of the gross rent. So the way withholding works is assume that you're supposed to, as a foreign investor, you're going to get $10,000 in rent. The payer of that rent, which is known as the withholding agent, which is generally the person renting the property or the property manager, is supposed to withhold 30% of that rent and pay it to the IRS and give you what's left. So if you're supposed to get $10,000 in rent, you're actually only going to receive $7,000, and $3,000 is supposed to go to the IRS as taxes. You do not get any deductions against this. The 30% is gone. This is the default way that you're supposed to be taxed. Now, unfortunately, most renters and property managers and foreign investors don't know this. They wind up running afoul of the rules and being liable for this 30% withholding tax down the road. Now, if you choose to be taxed based on the gross basis, which I don't know why you would want to do, you'd have to submit either a W-8-BEN in the case of an individual or a W-8-BENE in the case of an entity to the withholding agent. So again, that would generally be the renter or the property manager. So again, gross basis taxation, 30% tax on the gross rent, no deductions. This is the default method of taxation. So there is a better way of being taxed on your rental income as a foreign investor, and that is known as the net basis, which is basically what I think most people are used to. You have your rental income, you deduct your expenses, your depreciation, whatever's left is the profit. That's what you pay income tax on. That's what the net basis is. You do have that ability in the United States, but there's some steps that you have to take. So first of all, if you want to have your rental income taxed on the net basis, you have to make an election, electing to have that rental income treated as what's known as effectively connected income, or ECI income. If this election is made, the net income, so income less expenses, would be subject to U.S. income tax at the marginal income tax rates for individuals or entities, as the case may be. In order to make this election, the foreign investor would have to get an ITIN, which is an individual taxpayer identification number, in the case of an individual, or an EIN, employer identification number, in the case of an entity. Basically, that's a tax ID number. The election to have the rental income taxed on the net basis is made with the filing of a U.S. tax return. Also, a form W-8-ECI needs to be provided to the withholding agent, again, generally the renter or property manager. Income tax return needs to be filed. If it's estimated that the rental activity is going to generate a profit, you'd have to make the quarterly tax payments. And if you don't file the income tax return within 16 months of the due date, you lose the ability to claim any deductions and basically go back to this 30% withholding rate. So you want to be taxed on the net basis. It usually winds up being much more advantageous, but it's not quite as easy as just filing a tax return. You have to draft the election. You have to submit this W-8-ECI to the withholding agent. You have to get a tax ID number. So you really need a competent international tax advisor to make sure that this is done right, because a lot of times a rental activity, once you deduct the expenses and the depreciation, doesn't have a whole bunch of profit for tax purposes. And so the taxes are oftentimes quite low. And if you don't do this right, you go back to the default method of 30% of the gross rents, which generally is quite disadvantageous. So just a brief overview of the filing requirements. These filing requirements on this slide pertain to individuals. So non-resident aliens are required to file U.S. income tax returns. It's Form 1040-NR. Form 1040-NR is generally due April 15th for the previous tax year. If there were any wages that the foreign investor had that were subject to U.S. withholding. If not, the tax return is actually not due until June 15th. A six-month extension is available to file the tax return. It's very important to remember, The extensions in the US are only for filing the tax return. Any taxes that would be due need to be paid by the due date, so either April 15th or June 15th. So it's best to estimate what you may owe and overpay and then get a refund if you're going to file pursuant to an extension. In the case of a foreign entity, the due date would be either April 15th or March 15th, and there's generally a six-month extension available for entities as well. Again, if the foreign investor is an individual, they must obtain an ITIN. You can obtain an ITIN when filing the U.S. tax return. However, you need an ITIN to complete Form W-8-ECI, which is required to make for having the rental income taxed on the net basis. So you can't actually wait until you file the tax return to apply for the ITIN. You need to do that beforehand. Getting an EIN, which is a taxpayer identification number for an entity, is a little bit easier. You can apply for those directly with the IRS. You don't have to wait to file a tax return. So those basically are the ongoing income taxation requirements of foreign investors in U.S. real estate. So now we're going to talk about the Foreign Investment and Real Property Tax Act, or FIRPTA. What is FIRPTA? Foreign persons, so foreign investors, must pay tax on the gains from dispositions of U.S. real property interests. And we're going to break that sentence down a little bit later. But they're also required to file a tax return to report the gains and losses from the disposition of the U.S. real estate. Congress enacted the Foreign Investment Real Property Tax Act to ensure that tax is paid by foreign investors. So what used to happen before the enactment of FIRPTA in 1980, you'd have a foreign investor come to the U.S. They'd buy, you know, a house for $500,000. They would own it for a while. The house would go up in value. Now it's worth $800,000. They go and sell it. There's a $300,000 gain, and they just don't pay the tax on it. What's the government going to do? The foreign investor doesn't live in the U.S. They don't have any more assets in the U.S. The money's gone. They have no way to collect this tax. So basically, they enacted this legislation called FIRPTA. FIRPTA requires that tax be withheld on the amount realized by a foreign person from the disposition of a U.S. real property interest. So we're going to break this down a little bit more over the next slides. But basically, when a foreign investor disposes of U.S. real estate, which is generally through a sale, the buyer or withholding agent, we'll go through that again, of what exactly withholding agent is required to withhold part of that money from the proceeds of the sale and give it to the IRS so that the IRS is guaranteed to be owed or to be paid the tax. So first of all, if you recall from the previous slide, I said FIRPTA pertains to the disposition of a U.S. real property interest. Now, most people think that a disposition is just a sale, but that is not true. A disposition can be a sale, it can be a gift, it can be a redemption in the case of stock in a U.S. real property holding corporation, it can be a capital contribution to some type of a business entity, and other transfers. So basically, if a foreigner owns U.S. real estate and that U.S. real estate is going to be transferred out of the foreigner's name, most likely this transaction is going to be subject to FIRPTA. Going back to what I was saying, FIRPTA applies to a foreign investor's disposition of a U.S. real property interest. So we just discussed what dispositions are. Now we're going to talk about what a U.S. real property interest is. Most simply stated, a U.S. real property interest is a piece of real estate located in the United States owned directly by a foreign investor. There is also a couple of exceptions. Or not exceptions, but additional types of U.S. real property interest. For example, certain types of farming machinery related to the U.S. real estate can also be considered a U.S. real property interest. But next to owning U.S. real estate directly, the most common type of U.S. real property interest is what's known as a U.S. real property holding corporation. So U.S. real property holding corporation is a U.S. corporation where the U.S. whose U.S. real property interest equals or exceeds 50% of the sum of the fair market value of its U.S. real estate real property outside the US, certain business property. So basically, you know, the easiest way to describe this is if you have a US company and more than 50% of its assets are US real estate, then it's a US real property holding corporation, and the shares of that company are treated basically as if they're real estate. So if the shares of a US real property holding corporation are disposed of, then FRPTA would apply. So we've talked about dispositions. Dispositions are basically any time real estate's transferred out of a foreign investor's name, and a US real property interest, for all intents and purposes, is either real estate owned directly by a foreign investor or shares in a US real property holding corporation. In the business entity, could also be considered an amount realized. The FRPTA withholding is 15% of the amount realized by a foreign person who disposes of a US real property interest. This can be reduced to 10% withholding rate if the transferee acquires a personal residence with a purchase price not exceeding $1 million. The transferee recipient is the withholding agent and is required to withhold and pay tax to the IRS. Now, when I say the transferee, the recipient of the property, okay, not the money. So the way this actually works is this. Going back to my example, let's say we have a foreign investor who owns a house we paid $500,000 for, and he sells this house for $800,000. So there's a $300,000 gain, right? So let's assume it's not a personal residence and this 10% reduced withholding rate doesn't apply. So we're talking about a 15% withholding, right? So on $800,000, 15% withholding is $120,000, okay? So what would happen is the transferee, the recipient of the property, who's paying the $800,000 for the property, would actually only give the seller, the foreign investor, $680,000 and would give $120,000 of FRPTA withholding to the IRS, the 15%, okay? But the gain on the property was only $300,000. Assuming that this is long-term capital gain, the tax rate would be 20%. 20% of $300,000 is $60,000. So the IRS has double that. They have $120,000. So what would happen is if the foreign investor did not file a US tax return, the IRS would basically get to keep the $120,000. Okay? The foreign investor can file a tax return showing the sale of the property and showing that the gain was only $300,000 and the tax on that's only $60,000, and also showing that the IRS already has $120,000. Once that tax return is filed, the IRS would refund the other $60,000. And so the withholding agent, again, is the buyer. So the buyer is the one who's responsible for determining if the seller is a foreign investor, and if so, doing the FRPTA withholding and making sure that the withheld tax is in fact withheld and paid to the IRS. Now, one of the things that I want to mention is there is something called a withholding certificate that the foreign investor can apply for to have the FRPTA withholding reduced to the actual amount of tax due. And so the way that works is this. In the example I just gave, the actual tax is $60,000, not $120,000. So the foreign investor could apply for what's called a withholding certificate from the IRS, showing the calculation on the gain, which is only $300,000, the tax only being $60,000. The IRS would then issue a withholding certificate to the foreign investor saying that the FRPTA withholding is reduced from $120,000 to the actual tax of $60,000. That withholding certificate then would then be given to the buyer, the transferee, and he would then be required to only withhold the actual tax, the $60,000, rather than the entire FRPTA withholding of $120,000. Now, the taxes, the penalties for not complying with FRPTA are pretty harsh. You can see the buyer, being the withholding agent, is the one that's actually responsible for withholding this tax and paying it to the IRS. So if they don't do it, it's the buyer who's responsible for paying the tax, the late filing penalties, the late payment penalties, interest, as well as a $10,000 penalty if they willfully didn't comply with FERPTA. So that's in summation how FERPTA works. So now we're going to jump into gift and estate tax. U.S. gift tax does not apply to foreign investors except for when the gift is of U.S. tangible property, which includes U.S. real estate. So the U.S. gift tax applies to gifts made by a foreign investor of U.S. tangible property, which is basically property located in the U.S., and real estate. A foreign investor can give up to $15,000 worth of U.S. property to an unlimited number of persons. So, you know, just as an example, let's say you had a foreign investor that owned a property worth $100,000, and they wanted to gift this property to one of their children. $15,000 of that gift would be tax-free due to this $15,000 annual gift tax exclusion. The remaining $85,000, however, would be subject to a 40% gift tax, unless, of course, that gift was being given to a U.S. citizen spouse, in which case it would be a tax-free gift. But basically, any gifts of U.S. real estate made by a foreign investor are going to be subject to 40% gift tax over and above this $15,000. So that's something to be very mindful of when structuring an investment for a foreign investor in the U.S. real estate, that, you know, this gift tax could apply if they ever wanted to gift the property. And so there are some structures that can be used to own the real estate through business entities where this is not an issue, but you have to think of that before the investment is made and make that investment through a structure. Otherwise, you get stuck with the gift tax. One of the other things that a lot of foreign investors don't think about is the U.S. estate tax. So if a foreign investor dies while owning U.S. real estate, they only get a $60,000 estate tax exemption. Any value over $60,000 is going to be taxed at the U.S. estate tax rate of 40%. Let's say, for example, you have a foreign investor that has a house worth or a piece of property worth $1 million, and they die while they own it. $60,000 of that million is going to be tax-free, but $940,000 is going to be taxed at 40%. 40% of $940,000, it's more than a third of the value of the property that's going to be paid in taxes. There are structures that can be put in place that can avoid the U.S. estate tax for foreign investors. But those structures generally need to be put in place before the investment is made. They can be made they can be put in place after the investment is made, but you can't always migrate the investment into the structure completely tax-free. The only person that can really inherit tax-free from a foreign investor is a U.S. citizen spouse due to the marital deduction. To anybody else, you're going to have this reduced $60,000 estate tax exclusion. The U.S. does have several gift and estate tax treaties with various countries that modifies this $60,000 somewhat. But again, you need careful planning to see exactly what the impact of the treaty would be. Needless to say, the U.S. estate tax can be detrimental to a foreign investor in U.S. real estate. So it's very important to plan for this properly. Finally, this brings us to the end of the portion of the taxation of foreign investors in U.S. real estate. I wanted to just talk about the Bureau of Economic Analysis, or the BEA. These are some additional filing requirements that most foreign investors and their advisors are completely unaware of, but they're very important because they stiff penalties for not filing these forms. So any foreign investment in the U.S. needs to be reported to the BEA. The very first filing requirement is Form BE-13. This is the survey of new foreign direct investment in the United States. The BE-13 must be filed with the BEA within 45 days of making the investment. So this is very important. It's not a lot of time. It's not based on, you know, a calendar year or anything like that. It's 45 days. It has to be filed within 45 days of making the investment. This is a mandatory filing. So it's very important that that's done. There's also a form known as a BE605, which is a quarterly survey of foreign direct investment in the United States. This is basically to give the BEA an idea of foreign investors' levels of foreign investment in the US on a quarterly basis. This is only mandatory if you're contacted by the BEA and asked to file it. If you're not contacted by the BEA and asked to file it, you don't have to file it. That same holds true for BE15, which is an annual survey of foreign direct investment in the United States, which is, you know, basically the annual version of 605. It is not in lieu of BE605. BE15 is in addition to 605, and it's basically for the BEA to measure, you know, the amount of foreign investment in the United States throughout a year by various foreign investors. This only needs to be filed if contacted. If you are contacted, it's mandatory. Otherwise, it is not mandatory. You don't have to file it. BE12, form BE12 is a benchmark survey of foreign direct investment in the United States. This must be filed every 5 years, and filing is mandatory. There are, like with anything involving the U.S., severe penalties for not filing. That brings us to the end of our webinar. And so I thank you very much for attending. I hope to see you on a future webinar.